certainly hasn't worked in the Irish Republic, where the electorate have, they basically said that Gerry Adams and Martin Guinness, well done, lads, we love you, you're doing a great job in the peace process, but don't be coming down here to tell us what to do. That essentially was the lesson, the central message to Sinn Féin from the Irish electorate in the general election of 2007. It was, well done up there in the north, could you stay up there, please?
But, Henry, you were pointing out there's a whole generation grown up which the armed struggle is at best ancient history.
Well, it is. I mean, I'm glad that's the case. I mean, I've got three children, the oldest of which will be 12 soon, and they know nothing of the things that I lived through and, moreover, Anthony lived through on a much more intense basis. And that's a good thing, but one of the other reasons that prompted me to write this book was to sort of set a few truths straight and to say, look, guys, this is not about, you being able to have the same employment rights as a Protestant kid around the corner. It was about much more than that, and what it was about was not realized.
You know what, Henry? You and Anthony are setting the record straight from your own points of view, just as Ed Maloney did with the secret history of the IRA. Do you ever foresee the time of an MI5 or an MI6 agent writing out the strategy of what they use for the 30-year campaign, how they move certain members of the IRA into certain positions, did the shoot-to-kill policy, imprison certain people so other activists within their informer ranks, they could move into positions? Because that is probably one of the pieces of the puzzle that's missing right now. We know a lot about what went on in the IRA end, but we don't know all that much, I think, anyway, from the British intelligence end.
I don't know if you've spoken to a man called Martin Ingram, a former member of the Force Research.
Yeah, we had it. We had him on a few times.
He said a lot of interesting things to me off the record and stuff I have on tape, which validated that view that there was a clear strategy to promote the peace party within the Republican movement and to discredit whatever those who would stand in the way of that strategy. I would make a fascinating perspective, but here's your question in many ways answers a bigger. Your question is an answer to a bigger question. Will there be a Truth and Reconciliation Commission? Your question, I think, the upshot of it is no, because I don't think the British want that kind of stuff to tumble out of the cupboard, so to speak. I think there's a real reluctance to do that, because I think it would compromise an awful lot of people in political positions today.
Henry, I think one thing that unites everybody across the political spectrum, from the British to the Republicans to the DUP, nobody wants a Truth and Reconciliation Commission, but nobody wants the truth.
Quite. Exactly. Because everyone's compromised. I mean, it's like the collusion question. I make the point, I don't believe collusion was unidimensional, i.e. the Brits running loyalist agents alone. They were running loyalist agents. There's no question of that. And I've come across so many cases of it. But, there were people being allowed to commit crimes, if you want to call them crimes, or commit acts of violence, whatever terminology you want to use, in Republican organizations who were also state British agents as well. And you have to ask why that was the case.
Well, yes. In fact, it's recently come out that Danny Morrison, who you alluded to before, the former director of publicity for the Sinn Féin, who was arrested in an IRA safe house, agents of the British Secret Service may have been deeply involved in that, including Freddie Scapaticci, who is now revealed to be a British agent, who is then the deputy head of the intelligence division of the IRA.
He wasn't alone, Sandy. He was not
alone.
And the point, I support Danny Morrison's quest for the truth here, by the way. I think he's entitled to it. He went to jail because British state agents set him up. But the thing is that I think it's a highly embarrassing episode also for the Republican movement as much as the British.
I want to get into another one of the myths that Provisional Sinn Féin puts out, that the border is practically gone, that it doesn't exist. But I know going up this summer, you get a cell phone. It can detect the very second you cross the border.
Of course.
There's nothing but Union Jacks flying all over the place up north, more than I've ever seen. Also, I have Sirius satellite radio. And yesterday, I was listening to RTE. RTE's on twice a day. And they were discussing the budget and about how the shoppers along the border are they're not patriotic because they're shopping at Tesco in Enniskillen and Derry and going back and forth. I couldn't believe the conversation. Now, they recognize there's a border, but they were saying that the shoppers of Monaghan, Donegal, and Louth are unpatriotic because you're going up into the six counties, another country, a different statelet, different currency, different cell phones. And yet you'll have Sinn Féin saying, well, we have this cross-border thing. It's practically gone.
Let me just make – I'm actually going to Newry on Wednesday to do a report for our financial pages about how Newry is benefiting from the economic downturn in the South, okay?
Right.
Now, Brian Lenihan, the finance minister of Ireland, has actually said on the day of the budget last month that people should stop shopping in another state, okay? Now, that to me was fundamentally important because he is recognizing, at least he's honest about it, he's saying there's another state on this island. State of Northern Ireland.
Right.
And that's a fact. That's an economic and social fact. And it's something that Sinn Féin and its supporters kind of ignore. They actually benefit from it, too. They shop like everyone else.
But you know what, Brian? I drive a cab here in New York City. He could have also brought up about the people flying out of Limerick with empty suitcases flying into New York when the dollar wasn't good and filling them up on the weekend from Canal Street, all the knockoffs down there of pocketbooks and jeans, and flying back, because that is very unpatriotic. They should have been shopping.
That's global capitalism, I think.
And Anthony, you've moved from Belfast to down to the south. What's it like? I mean, do you feel like you're living in the same state that you were before?
No, absolutely not. I'm living in a state that's by and large indifferent to what happens in the north.
Where do you shop, Anthony?
I shop down here. I shop in the south only because I'm a creature of convenience, and it suits me to shop down here. But I suppose, like most people, if I was living near the border, the Sinn Féin pretend doesn't exist, I would be exploiting it to shop in the north and get stuff cheaper. You know, there's a completely different attitude. And, you know, at my stage in life, you know, I'm now in my early 50s, and it was the only chance I was ever going to have to live under a government that at least, whether you like it or not, you could at least say I was Irish rather than British.
Well, at least you could say, Anthony, that you were living in a society where you wouldn't be locked up for your views, or you would not have pickets outside your door.
Well, that's true. The next-door neighbour doesn't come out and hound me because I mightn't like Gerry Adams, or I might have a certain brand of politics. You know, and I might oppose Mr. Adams' politics. He's not out holding his nose and saying, I will not talk to you.
Which happened to you, Anthony. That happened to you, actually, when you were living in Belfast, and much more than that. I mean,
oh, yes. I was hassled. I mean, absolutely hassled. Picketed, ostracized. Generally given a hard time by them, simply because I foreseen what was coming and I had the audacity to tell them it. And now they're all, everything that they denied would happen, I predicted would happen.
Including decommissioning, can I point out, Anthony was the first person I know in public life, in letters, in writing, who said there would be decommissioning. In fact, he was, at the time, I was trying to overcome my skepticism about what he was saying, but he was right. I remember people in the mainstream media, people in the BBC, for instance, literally laughing at his assertion that there'd be decommissioning. Well, he was right in the end.
And Henry, when you go to cover the financial crisis or what's going on in Newry, along the border areas in Donegal, particularly where people go for petrol or gas, I mean, it's complete devastation depending on which way the economic downturn goes. There's no petrol stations in the north near the border.
That's changed last
week. That's changing.
There's been another 360-degree turn. Petrol has fallen in the north, and now the stations are reopening again. But I would point out that, for instance, a town like Letterkenny is complaining that everybody in Letterkenny is going to Derry to shop. And they're shopping, by the way, in British multiple retail stores, you know, like Tesco's and Nasdaq and whatnot, you know. So the border still exists. It still has an economic impact. I mean, you talk to people who live, I have relatives in Donegal, you talk to them and they'll say the northerners, when they come over for their holiday homes at the weekends, they stock up in British department stores and like Tesco's and Asda, and they get all their wine and their food in before they cross the border, and they don't spend a penny in Donegal. So there's that kind of partitionist resentment that exists, you know.